So we are delighted to have with us for the next talk Dr. Armin Schwarzbach, who has been at the forefront of tick-borne research for over two decades. His expertise in diagnosing and treating infectious diseases is second to none, having tested over 20,000 patients. Before establishing his own laboratory, Dr. Schwarzbach was the co-founder and CEO of the Borreliosis Clinic in Augsburg and laboratory manager of InfectoLab in Germany. He has many, many accolades. He's also an advisory board member of the Academy of Nutritional Medicine, a board member of the German Borreliosis Society, a member of the ILADS, and he serves as an expert on advisory committees on Lyme disease in Australia, Ireland, France, and Germany. Dr. Schwarzbach.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for your welcome here. Thank you for that great talks today. Very good information from Jean and from Dietrich. And also, great thank you, John, for your action here and your great talks. Thank you so much for all the patients and all doctors. It's not so easy. I tested nearly 1,000 samples now from England, I think so, and it seems really to be a problem here. I'm astonished or shocked by myself that so many tests are positive. Maybe it's high endemic, it's epidemic. We cannot tell exactly what's behind that. I want to give you an overview of the infections and viruses that is important to consider the testing for in chronic conditions, such as multiple encephalitis you heard about, multiple sclerosis, rheumatoid arthritis, fibromyalgia, Alzheimer's disease, Al McDonald talked about, Parkinsonism, autism. The list is much longer. We have also problems with ALS, motor neuron diseases. It's just a little spectrum about that. The question is, all of these illnesses are just description of symptoms. That doesn't mean that there's a reason behind. I'm a medical doctor, I'm a traditional medical doctor, I want to know the reason behind. That's my aim, to find out what's the reason for such symptoms or not. And the next challenge was to offer tailored testing protocols also for these conditions beyond Lyme disease. I will tell you, Lyme is a starter. I thought 10 years ago everybody in Germany has Lyme, but not in the rest of the world. And then the first patients from Sweden came, and I thought, Sweden, Lyme disease, doesn't exist. But Sweden is full of ticks. We have a region in Åland, 50% of the people are sick of Lyme disease in Sweden. And we have just one doctor in whole Sweden caring for the Lyme patients. So we have next weekend, Basant, we have a big conference also together in Stockholm, and we hope that we can change a little Sweden. We need John in Sweden too. We need in every country, John, we need you. We need Johns. Johns, we have to clone you. Thank you. So it's a lot of stuff I want to tell. We have a lot of tests. Tests are difficult for you to understand. I learned it 6 years during my study. I cannot bring you whole laboratory medicine. That's not your job. You should trust what we laboratory doctors do. I will talk about CD3, CD57 count, ELISpot spot test, SeraSpot. I will talk about Chlamydia, Mycoplasma, Ehrlichia, Anaplasma, Bartonella, Babesia, Rickettsia, EBV, CMV, H herpes virus 1, 2, 6, etc., etc. So, and the parasites, Dietrich is not here, but Dietrich is right. We have big problems in diagnosing parasites, actually. There's just one laboratory in America, Stephen Fry, who cares for parasites. But the next aim should be also to look for more for parasites, because this seems to be also a problem in the multiple infections. So what we are talking about, we have three systems in our immune defense. The first system are the natural killer cells. The second system is the Th1 system, that means the T cells. And the third system, where we all look for, are the antibodies, that's the Th2 system. You know, the medical world changed. When I was 20 years old, it came up with HIV infections. HIV we diagnosed by antibody test. Then we looked for the natural killer cells, CD56 cells. That's similar to CD57. Also, Ray Stricker in San Francisco, he detected that CD56 in his Lyme patients are not significant. The CD57 count is important. CD57 natural killer cells, very important in chronic bacterial infection. They destroy the antigen-antibody complexes. But what we forgot in the whole laboratory world is the Th1 system. We learned now from tuberculosis that the tuberculosis patients, they react not on the B cells, on the antibodies, they react on the T cells. And this is everywhere in the world established, we talk later about. So the T cells are my specialty, actually the antibodies are important. I'm more on the way to IgA, no, the IgM is not so interesting for us in the laboratory, but we look more for IgA as a sign for an active infection. The CD57 count. This is one paper from 2001 from Ray Stricker and Winger. They found in patients with chronic neuroborreliosis in 100% low CD57 count. This is the only study we have, but there's not on the opposite side, no study showing not that in chronic Lyme it cannot be low. Joe Borescano, he did a presentation in 2006 about this CD57 count. He showed very impressive that the lower, the higher is the probability that patients are suffering from chronic Lyme. But I have asked Ray Sticker that question. Ray, could it be that also in other infections CD57 count can be low? And he said, Armin, yes, do some studies for it. Yes, he could not answer that question. My impression is that it's not highly specific CD57 count. It can be low also in chlamydia infections and mycoplasma infections and maybe some other bacterial infections. So we need studies for that. We need studies for that. We had last weekend a meeting with the German Borreliosis Society on a scientific level, and we discussed also with the University of Ulm that point, CD57 count. Also their observation is that we have to care for CD57 counts. Very important. It's a flow cytometry method, very good method, but we need more science for that. The ELISpot, that's my heart. I started with this LTT in 2006 also. I will show you later when it began. And the ELISpot is now a very established test. We are looking for the actual activity of the T cells, not for the B cells. B cells are responsible for antibody production, but the T cells are directly fighting against bacteria, viruses, or in environmental medicine, also Breakspace using the test against different toxins. So it reflects the actual activity of chronic and recent infections. The sensitivity, you don't know what sensitivity is, or your doctor. Sensitivity means the not false negative is 84%. So if you have 100 patients with active Lyme infections, 16 of these hundreds don't have any positive ELISpot. That's sensitivity. And each test has a sensitivity and a specificity. Specificity is 94%. That means, nevertheless, 6% or 6 of 100 patients can be false positive. Our enemies or our the majority of doctors, they say this ELISpot is unspecific. We come to that point too. They say everybody has it now. That's absolutely nonsense. It's not the truth. They say it's unspecific. Why? There's no argument why it should be unspecific. What my problem is, it's not unspecific, it's insensitive too. What about this 16%? We know that patients who are very, very sick, they have a very low CD57 count and they have no T cells. Why? Because they have secondary T cell immune suppression and they cannot produce it. If you treat them, they got Herxheimer-like reactions, then they explode with the T cells. That's very, very good. If you have a T cell response, the higher your immune response, the better it is for you, the natural immune defense, although you are sick and you have symptoms. But you have to understand in the other way. It's good that if you have antibodies, it's good, it's protection, it's your police, it's your immune defense. So why is it not unspecific? It cannot be unspecific because the antigens are the same we use in the Western blots. And the Western blots, they say it's a gold standard. You know, there's a Western blot, it's a gold standard. So it cannot be unspecific. If you discuss about not specificity with mite ELISpot, then you have to discuss all with the Western blot. This is political. You know, that's absolutely political, and this is, John, that's your field. You know, it's political. It's nothing, it's not scientific. We don't discuss about science, we discuss about policy. And thank you, John. So we complement each other in many scientists with you. So these are the antigens we use in this test. We have the Borrelia burgdorferi full antigen. It's from the reference strain, the B31, which is used also in very, very often in the immunoplot test. We have this peptide mix, very important. We find more and more neurological immune answers, OSPA. We have the Afzelia in it and Garinii. And Professor Melli, he sent me a lot of samples. He's a chronic fatigue specialist and from Brussels. We found around 70% Lyme disease in chronic fatigue patients in his group from Belgium and from other countries. So very important in this ELISpot, also the LFA1. It's a third antigen we use. It's a lymphocyte function antigen 1. It's an on-body protein. It's from sensu stricto. It's named the shared epitope. And if we find LFA1, the message is, please look in this patient for autoimmune disorders because Borrelia burgdorferi can be the reason for rheumatoid arthritis, for collagenosis, vasculitis. So you have to care also for autoimmune disorders. The test is very helpful in this field too. So there's American laboratory also, they do the ELISpot it's named, and they did some studies. They said the sensitivity of the ELISpot is estimated at 84%, specificity is 94%. They say ELISpot assays provide robust, highly reproducible data. I'm not doing this test. I don't produce that test. I'm a user of the test. It's a CE certified test. There are some other laboratories in Germany also doing this ELISpot, and more coming now in southern France is now a laboratory doing that test. You cannot stop a development. You know, it's laboratory medicine is developing more and more better, I hope so. The tests and the two test systems, ELISpot and CD57 count, they complement each other in the quest to understand the T cell mediated immunity in vivo. So altogether, we have around specificity 94% and sensitivity 84%. That's the question. I mean, can you prove my disease? I got so many mails. Can I prove a disease by a test? I cannot prove it because I don't have the bacteria in front of me. To prove something, you need directly to see this bacteria in the blood or in the tissue, like Al McDonald did the job. That's the job of a pathologist, and to prove it directly. But these are indirect tests. If you have symptoms for Lyme disease, we come later to that, and the tests are positive, these tests results support the clinical diagnosis. What does that mean? That the doctors, they have to learn a lot about symptomatology and how a Lyme disease symptoms can be expressed in a patient and the differential diagnosis. That is not so easy, so not every doctor is able to do good anamnesis. If you, for example, you're working as a surgeon, you don't have the time to do 1 hour anamnesis with a patient. And to find out if a patient has Lyme disease or some other infections, you need really time. 1 or 2 hours are nothing. And the normal health insurance, they pay a doctor in Germany 6 minutes for in 3 months contact with a patient. So anamnesis is not possible by normal health insurances. It's like doing oncology or doing hormonal or some other problems. You need specialists for that chronic infection. It's not possible to do it by each GP. They don't have the time to do it. And you need the experience. It's not possible. Currently, the ELISpot is available for Borrelia burgdorferi. We have 3 subspecies, Garinii, Afzelia, and Sensu stricto. What about Miyamoto? I cannot tell you. Chlamydia pneumonia, that's my favorite, my second favorite. Chlamydia trachomatis, yeah, you know my presentations, I know some of you. Ehrlichia, Yersinia species. We come later to Alan MacDonald, to the Chlamydia story. Epstein-Barr virus, and the starter is Borrelia, but we are more and more on the way to the viruses. Epstein-Barr virus plays a very, very important role, also cytomegalovirus, herpes simplex virus, and the Coxsackie virus. We come later. What about now the immunoblot? Immunoblot time will end in 2 or 3 years in the bigger laboratory groups. In England, not, because in England, Lyme disease is a rare disease, so you don't need many tests here. You do a very few tests in Portendown or what you do. That's funny. I went to Denmark some years ago. In Denmark, they said, we don't have immunoblot here. Well, that's strange, you don't. In Aarhus, was the University of Aarhus, we just do ELISA, we don't need immunoblot, they told me there. And I said, why not? Yeah, there's a study from Hansen, this guy, he did a study 10 years ago, we don't need Western blots here in Denmark. That's strange. Why? And it came out that Hansen was the owner of this company producing the ELISA, so that was the conflict of interest, a big discussion in the Danish television and everywhere. So what about your rare disease in England? It's a rare disease, yeah. Your NHS is thinking actually this way, but if you will bring this test out from Portendown, you need bigger laboratories doing it. In Germany, we have, my former laboratory was the SYNLAB group. Now they have 2 billion turnover with 10,000 employees, and they are doing not one test, they do hundreds of Lyme disease tests, and they do now the more the industrialization of the microarray, that you have heard it. The next step in laboratory will be the microarray. I brought some to my information booth, you can look at it. It's a spot technique, like this ELISpot, spot, spot, spot. The whole world is changing. No, it's a 96 microwell array, which is very easy for my assistants in the laboratory. I have 13 employees. They like my system to work with it. They like the Sierra spot. Immunoplot time will go over, you know. It's a question of time, also laboratory. And we need bigger series to test it. And this you can automize. Very good test, although it's not excluding Lyme disease. That depends also on the antigens and the sensitivity of the test system. It's processed like an ELISA at the end. It's a special reader we have for it. It tests for all three different Borrelia subspecies. It's very important that you here in Europe don't get tested in other laboratories like Igenics, because Igenics, they test not for Garinii and Aphtheliae, and you miss that information, for example. So it's really important that you ask your laboratory or Portendown, do you test for all subspecies, and do you test also for VLSE? VLSE is an in vivo activity for Borrelia burgdorferi. So here it tests 99% specificity. That's very good, nearly 100%. Mathematically, for the young people, you cannot reach 100% specificity by a test system. That's not possible. Also, Alan MacDonald cannot reach 100%. That's not possible. He can reach 99.999. It's like winning money. It's really difficult to reach 100%. So we all cannot prove or exclude 100%. We use also native antigens in combination with recombinant antigens. The SeraSpot has the big advantage that it can quantify also the immune answer. The Western blot cannot do it. It's a semi-quantitative method. It's a no quantification possibility that makes it very easy also for laboratories to work with it. So what should you do now in the basic diagnostic tests? You are forced to do the antibodies by the systems, the IgM and IgG by the microarray. Don't forget the sensitivity we find is around 60% in chronic. The problem is all tests for the antibodies, they were established for scientific purpose just for stage 1 and 2, but not for chronic Lyme, because chronic Lyme doesn't exist. FDA, the CDC, they say chronic Lyme doesn't exist. The patient is a little stupid and it's imagination. They name it post-treatment Lyme disease syndrome, PTLDS. So they don't have reference ranges. They don't have a case definition for chronic Lyme. It doesn't exist, you know. If something doesn't exist, you don't need a test for it. But why, you can ask Portnow, why do you do tests for chronic Lyme patient? It doesn't exist, so you don't need to send any samples for the question chronic Lyme or not. It doesn't exist. That's the problem. Borrelia illispot is my heart. It's very helpful in the actual activity, and the CD57 cells. Doing all tests together, you have sensitivity over 90% and 99% specificity. That's a slide from Dietrich. Dietrich, I have stolen your slide, but you allowed me that. I know that. That was very interesting. You name it Lyme borreliosis, the great imitator. It's a chameleon. It's a great imitator. It can move everywhere around the body. It can do every symptom. It can do, you can get a hair loss, for example. You can get lose testosterone. You can go to the restrooms the whole life because of ADH problems temporarily. We want to talk today a little about autistic disorders. We know that 20 up to 30%, that's a study by Bob Bransfield, of autistic disorders can be caused by Borrelia, 58 per mycoplasma, multiple sclerosis, myelopathies, polyneuropathies, brain tumor, encephalopathies. It can cause Borrelia burgdorferi, meningitis, encephalitis, neuritis, mania, depression, schizophrenia, anorexia, dementia. 90% of chronic fatigue patients are Lyme positive. Most fibromyalgia patients are Lyme positive. Borrelia can cause Parkinsonism. And at the bottom, there's a very interesting paper. It came out in 2014 in volume 4. That was the end, 2014. It's very important with this discussion, Alan MacDonald. Pure Lyme dementia exists and has a good outcome after antibiotics. It is advisable to do Lyme serology in demented patients. That's a paper, we have that. Who knows that paper? Nobody. This literature is systematically, it's suppressed in the guidelines. The guidelines are the bad thing behind the guidelines. They say it's guidelines, but they are not guidelines. They are recommendations on an expert level. We discussed last weekend in Germany, they try now to bring it onto a S2 level with the aim of S3 recommendation. And they are experts, they say here. Acrodermatitis, if you have acrodermatitis, chronic atrophicans, these experts, they say, you must have IgG antibodies. And you ask them, where are the studies behind? No studies behind. They say, I'm the law, I'm the doing the guidelines. Can you imagine that? Dermatologists in Germany, I cannot tell you the name, who is doing damaging patients by this. So if you don't have IgG antibodies, you don't have acrodermatitis, you don't have chronic Lyme disease. That's a postulation in these new guidelines. We have to be very careful. The pressure is very high on us. They want to put it all on a higher level against all of us that it doesn't exist. So always political, always political. Chlamydia pneumonia, that's really my favorite. You know the story about the koalas? I told you the koala story, Australia. I had a park ranger from Australia. Carl McManus, he died after Mahler did a foundation. Now Mahler McManus, maybe you heard, he came to me some years ago. And my idea behind was in Australia, okay, they could have some Borrelia in the ticks because this patient was so sick with a borreliosis and chlamydia infection. And then the park rangers, they told me the veterinarians, they put all the koalas from the trees when they have chronic fatigue syndromes. They are lying on the trees, you know, the koalas. And then they diagnose the koalas, the veterinarians, they diagnose the koalas with chlamydia infections. And then they put the koalas into hospitals. It exists, really. Go to Australia, go to koala hospital, and they got long-term infusion with antibiotics. The koalas. And then they bring all the koalas back to the trees and then they're active and happy again and no Alzheimer in the koalas. Yeah, they have chronic fatigue syndrome and they are sick, very sick, the koalas. So if a park ranger got sick, They say, no, 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 it doesn't exist. You don't need any diagnosis. Work harder, work harder. You're looking pretty good. So what happens there in the world? It happens the veterinarians are one step in front of us. If you plan something, you need the veterinarians. They know much more about all these things than we know, because the animal, horses or frogs, they can get very sick by these infections. This is accepted, but not for humans. Okay, they don't have political parties for the koalas. They cannot discuss it politically, maybe. So what about chlamydia? Chlamydia is just intracellular, very important. All co-infections, all viruses are intracellular. Just Borrelia burgdorferi is extracellular, but can move intracellular. That's for therapies, very important. Intracellular, what does it mean, protection? Also, Alan MacDonald showed you the biofilms and all the protection. So chlamydia pneumoniae, it does exactly the same symptoms like you have in Lyme disease. So we all know Dietrich Leider-Mettmann, this book with the stealth phenomena. She described it years ago. She was nearly winning the Nobel Prize, really, but she didn't win it because she was getting very old. And she described in chlamydia infections, Alzheimer's disease, multiple sclerosis, depression, fibromyalgia, multiple encephalitis, chronic fatigue syndrome, heart attacks, acute ischemic strokes, atherosclerosis, autism, Parkinsonism, rheumatoid arthritis, etc. So you have to ask each Lyme patient, do you have some cough or some sinusitis? Because this chlamydia is in your body, and then it's together, we don't know the mechanisms. Is it in the ticks, or is it's an aerogen transmitted, so we have in families. The question is, can it be transmitted by ticks? They found it in ticks now. I'm making jokes, but they say if a tick is coughing at the other tick, then they get infected each other with chlamydia. You know, the coughing tick. Yeah, there can be chlamydia infection, for example. Or horses, if you're a horse rider, the horse can cough at you, and then it transmits this chlamydia pathogen into your body, and then you get your sinusitis, and then you get atherosclerosis or Alzheimer's disease. And it was found by Alan MacDonald also in the tissue. He didn't talk today about chlamydia. He found, and Judith McLoshy also, they found chlamydia pneumonia in the tissue of Alzheimer's disease patients, both, not just Borrelia. Mycoplasma is nearby. Mycoplasma makes also fatigue, fever, joint pain, joint swelling, muscle pain, headache, insomnia, anxiety, emotional volatility, lack of concentration. Garth Nicholson described that with the Gulf War I syndrome, also the multiple encephalitis. What's Gulf War I syndrome? All the soldiers came back from, and Garth Nicholson's daughter also, she was a helicopter pilot in Gulf War I, and she came back and she got sick after a while with mycoplasma infection. He found out the mycoplasma, and the whole family got sick. The children, they got autistic by that. So mycoplasma is aerogen transmitted, and it was also found in ticks. I don't know if also there's a reason behind. We have pneumonia and fermentans, and this is also biofilm maker. Chlamydia makes biofilm, mycoplasma makes biofilm, they all make biofilms, you know. They are so nearby. There are some hypotheses that they all come from a very old bacteria and can convert into different species of other bacteria. Ehrlichia anaplasma, that's Ehrlichia, also intracellular. In Germany, in rheumatoid arthritis, 30% of the patients in the southern part, they have also Ehrlichia and Borrelia infections, so they have two infections. And in Germany, 6 up to 8% of the ticks are full of Ehrlichia anaplasma. My wife was bitten in my garden, and I did tick testing. There was no Borrelia, but my tick in my garden was full of Ehrlichia. Can you imagine? I thought it's Borrelia, but it was Ehrlichia in the tick. So why is it important to test the tick? Because I want to know what's going on with my wife. You would do also. You would also don't throw away the ticks. Keep the ticks and do test them for what's inside the tick. Then you know what it is. You have a risk or not. The PCR is the Nobel Prize method for it. Ehrlichia makes musculoskeletal symptoms very often, so it's fitting also to rheumatoid arthritis, fibromyalgia. Bartonella is very common. with Borrelia together. A lot of people have or had cats. You have to ask for a cat. It's a cat scratch disease. We have also the Quintana. It's a trench fever called. We have Bartonella baciliformis. We have a lot of other subspecies. It's also on the ticks. Up to 40% of ticks in Germany and Europe are contaminated with Bartonella. So it's so important to look at the ticks to know where it's endemic, where is the hotspot, is it maybe in your garden, is it in the other garden. So you have to test the ticks and don't throw the ticks away after tick bite. Keep the tick, it can be very important to look afterwards what was in the tick. Sandflies can also, mosquitoes can also bring it. Also question Borrelia, in some cases horseflies and mosquitoes can transmit Borrelia burgdorferi in your body. There are papers about that, if you don't know about it. So Bartonella, what does it make? It makes tiredness, headache, muscle twitches, tremors, seizures, fever in the morning. It makes swollen lymph nodes, arthralgia, myalgia, insomnia, depression, agitation, severe mood swings, very important, lack of concentration, dizziness, anxiety, very important symptom, outburst, antisocial behavior, very important, restlessness, gastritis, intestinal symptoms, sores, especially in the morning, tender, subcutaneous nodules, and the problems can be later endocarditis, retinitis. So, Jean, you talked about that organ transplantations and all these things. Very important to look also for Bartonella in this. These are the typical striae. You cannot believe how many doctors miss that diagnosis. It's very easy to look on the skin of a patient. This doesn't hurt. It's not dangerous by itself. But GPs, they don't look at the skin, at these stretch marks. Very important. It's nearly proving the diagnosis. You can do some biopsies, and it can also be reactivated, these striae. Many patients have this, but you have to inspect the patient. But if you have 6 minutes time, within 3 months, you cannot do that. You don't have the time for it. Babesia very important for with the blood transfusions. It's malaria-like symptoms, and also L. McDonald talked about the organ transplantation and the blood transfusions. There was a death case in North Southern Wales in Australia, proven death case, immune-suppressed patients got a blood transfusion with Babesia in it without knowing about it, and this patient died. So Australia is also discussing about to test before blood transfusions the erythrocytes, because it's in the erythrocytes. Rickettsia is the next thing. I had a patient from Belarus last week, from Minsk. He came to my office and he got infected in Barcelona, and I found very high Rickettsia titer in this patient. We don't find so many. But I will look now for more serum from him for some studies. Rickettsia is dangerous for the perimyocarditis and kidney insufficiencies. Not everybody got this problem. Also intracellular. Now to the viruses. Epstein-Barr virus, you heard about that. It was actually not found in the ticks yet, but nobody looked at it. Epstein-Barr virus is intracellular. It's a double-stranded DNA virus. It makes the mononucleose, the kissing disease of the young people. It can be in the saliva, drinking from the same glass, in the toothbrush, blood, sexual transmission, blood transfusion, organ transplantation. The symptoms are so important because it makes fatigue, fever, flu-like symptoms, nausea, loss of appetite, etc., etc. So Epstein-Barr is very common, and we have also many people, they lost their job because of EBV, of the chronic fatigue syndrome. The cytomegalovirus, it's another virus in this complexity. The incubation is over several weeks. It was it's found in urine, in saliva, breast milk, it can be sexual transmitted, organ transplantation, blood transfusion, and it makes the lymph adenitis, and the complications are congenital infections, hearing loss, vision loss, seizures, mental disabilities, lack of concentration. It plays a very important role in Spain. Also, Jean, you know about in Spain with the environmental, we discussed it, and patients, they seem to have a lot of CMV problems additionally on the first place, I don't know. Herpes simplex virus, you all know about herpes of the lips. We can test it, we have good tests, we have the IgA, we have the ELISpot meanwhile, but herpes simplex virus makes also multiple sclerosis, loss of vision, encephalitis, can be latent infection, and muscle fever aches, etc. HHV6, another virus, also doing multiple sclerosis. It's a cofactor in chronic fatigue syndrome, fibromyalgia. This information I got from the internet, also from scientific papers, so I don't want to tell you anything which is hypothesis. That's all described in the literature research, that HHV6, and I had one patient now with a positive DNA for it. Coxsackie, I don't know how to handle. I think in England you all have Coxsackie infections. I'm really shocked about that a little. I don't know how to answer that question. Nearly everybody has an IgA sending me the sample. My lab team says something is wrong with our test. No, I said this sample is from England. So in England it's high endemic, the Coxsackie. It's enterovirus. We have two different groups, A and B. Group A makes the herpes angina and some conjunctivitis, the hand, foot, and mouth disease. Group B makes myocarditis, pericarditis. The complications are CNS, similar to poliomyelitis, systemic neonatal disease, and the insulin-dependent diabetes can be caused by Coxsackie. Group A makes generalized myositis, and group B makes muscle injuries. And I don't know how to handle actually with it. Why are so many patients with the IgA I found? IgA is the laboratory parameter for an actual IgA local inflammation, and a gene also, you presented it with your, what you're doing in your field. So it's corresponding with the IgA, and maybe there's a correlation, I don't know actually. So here are my tailored testing protocols for fibromyalgia, rheumatoid arthritis, multiple sclerosis, ME, dementia, Yersinia, and EBV and CMV. Most fibromyalgia patients are Lyme positive. We heard about that. Our oldest patient with fibromyalgia, John, 5,300 years ago, Ötzi the Iceman. So Lyme disease exists nearly 6,000 years ago. You know how old is Borrelia burgdorferi? How old do you think that bacteria? Bazant, question for you. You're the scientist here on the table. 15 million years, very good. 15 million years old. It was nearly good. So how old is the oldest tick? Bazant, next question. How old is the oldest tick? Somebody knows the oldest tick?
100 million.
Ah, very good. No, a little 40 million years old, was found in Bernstein. You saw Jurassic Park, or? So, Ötzi's enemies were the ticks, because they found tattoos on the Iceman's spine and ankles and behind his right knee that he tried to treat himself because of his fibromyalgia symptoms. But he didn't know about Lyme disease. 6,000 years, he didn't have my ELISA spot. I was not living there. And he didn't have the antibody test, so your NHS, your Porton down, doesn't exist. So really, the Iceman's very old disease, very old. So in Middle Ages, the whole lifetime of a... And we think that in Middle Ages, many people got aggressive. They have Lyme disease. If you have Lyme disease, you can get aggressive. And you do a lot of wars also. We know that. Because if you are so sick and you get dementia, some kings... I don't know how many in England got statistically... So that would lead too far. That would lead too far. But I want to say, it's a very, very old illness. It's no young disease. But it's just for us in medicine, 30 years old, a very young disease, like HIV. That's the problem behind. So in fibromyalgia, you should be tested for Borrelia by the the immunoplot, or what you want to do. The ELISA spot and CD57 cells, you should be tested for chlamydia infections, pneumonia, also for trachomatis, is a sexual transmitted chlamydia infection, for mycoplasma, for Ehrlichia anaplasma, for rickettsia, for Yersinia, for Coxsackie virus, HHV6, and for the ANA, anti-autoimmune disorders too. That should be a good panel for rheumatoid arthritis, also for Ötzi that time to be tested. Multiple sclerosis, we have a lot of correlation now, Lyme borreliosis and multiple sclerosis, association between multiple sclerosis and cystic structures. Multiple sclerosis, I want to show you my case now, where I started with that, and I was so shocked about that. I worked for Synlab, and I learned if the ELISA is negative, Lyme disease is excluded. All my teachers, the microbiologists, I had good teachers in different laboratories and universities, they all told me, Armin, if it's negative, you can exclude Lyme disease. And then a patient like you, sitting in one of my presentations, 2006, she suffered from May 2005 from persistent paresthesia of the left leg, 80% blindness of the left eye, progressive myalgia, recurrent dizziness, substantial loss of stamina, high risk of occupational disability, that's political. You cannot imagine how much money got lost by patients like that. Not just in Germany, also in England, everywhere. So this risk of occupational disability that costs a lot of money for the social systems, you cannot imagine that number. There are some statistics from Switzerland, over 200,000 Schweizer Franken for 1 year. The diagnosis by a neurologist was multiple sclerosis. That's very typical because the spinal fluid and laboratory tests all were negative. No antibodies, no IgG synthesis, everything negative. The IgM ELISA and IgG and immunoglobulin completely negative. And what do they do now? That's the next step. They use corticosteroids. They suppress your immune system. And this was the reason for increasing symptoms in her case, and she suffered from bad side effects because these corticosteroids, they make diabetes after a while and cortisol problems, so she got more and more. I did a testing then, that was the first time with this LTT, the ELISpot and the CD57, and it was a high activity. The doctor was calling me after that report. I told, I was not so sure that time. I said to the doctor, maybe she has MS, multiple sclerosis, plus neuroborreliosis without any findings by the antibodies. And that patient got cured from multiple sclerosis till nowadays by 8 weeks Rosefin. I cured a patient with multiple sclerosis. She's not here. There was a lot of television after that and a lot of action after that, but nothing happened in Germany. It's a very static system. The correct diagnosis for me, it was a chronic neuroborreliosis because she got cured by this Rosefin and my findings. The laboratory tests all go down, CD57 went up, with multiple sclerosis-like symptoms. So I want to discuss, not to discuss with any neurologist about MS, but I tell them the patient can have lice and flea together. It can be neuroborreliosis, accept this, and it can be multiple sclerosis, you are right with your diagnosis. But what my find, and then there's say, yes, I can try to treat this patient with antibiotics. That's a good strategy. You can try it out. So what to do in these patients? You can do, or you should do the antibodies, the ELISpot for Borrelia CD57 cells, the chlamydia. Chlamydia is very highly associated with multiple sclerosis. Mycoplasma, you should look for Bartonella. You should look for Coxsackie virus. You have to look for EBV. You have to look for CMV and HHV6. This is what I found, Bartonella. And chlamydia has a very high correlation with multiple sclerosis. It must not be Borrelia. It can be also chlamydia. We have to be careful to say everybody has now Lyme infection or Borrelia infection. The truth is always in the middle. You have to find out. 90% of chronic fatigue patients are Lyme positive. In chronic fatigue or ME, you should look for Borrelia, you should look for Chlamydia pneumoniae, you should look for Mycoplasma, Bartonella and Parvovirus, also very important, B19, Parvovirus B19, Coxsackie virus, EBV, CMV, herpes and HHV6. That would be my recommended strategy there. Pure Lyme dementia exists and has a good outcome after antibiotics. It is advisable to do Lyme serology. Lyme is okay, but you have also to look for chlamydia, mycoplasma, Coxsackie virus in Alzheimer, as in herpes and EBV and CMV. Borrelia can cause Parkinsonism, correct, we accept that. You have to look for Borrelia, for chlamydia, mycoplasma, Bartonella, Coxsackie, EBV, CMV, you see always nearly the same. Autism, very important, these findings by Bob Pransfield and also by Dietrich. You did a good job also with autistic children the last decades of years, I think so. You are a fascinating therapist for me. Thank you. Autism, you should look for Borrelia infections, for Chlamydia, Mycoplasma, that's the trias. We discussed that in Indian Wells some years ago, remember? Dietrich told me, I look also, please look for Mycoplasma in autism and Chlamydia, Bartonella, important, Coxsackie virus, Epstein-Barr virus, CMV virus, and the ASL titer with this pandas that came up today. So the question is, multiple symptoms, multiple infections. The starter for me was Lyme 10 years ago. For that patient, I didn't look for chlamydia. Judith McLoshy and Al McDonald, they brought me to that chlamydia way. I'm convinced of that. I see it daily. There is no pure Lyme disease. You can say pure Lyme disease doesn't exist. All patients have some co-infections or opportunistic infections. I learned from you, Dietrich. Opportunistic, like in HIV model, that's correct in my eyes what you did the definition. So long we don't find it in the tick, we cannot say it's a co-infection, you know. But if we find something in the tick and we prove the transmission, then we can say it's a multiple infection by different bacteria and viruses. They found also Coxsackie virus in ticks, interestingly, in a study. You know that, Dietrich, it was in USA. They found 10 years ago Coxsackie virus in the tick, and the people got sick with diarrhea afterwards, and they had antibodies. But nobody looked afterwards for more patients, is it endemic or no? No studies about that afterwards. But it shows you now that the symptoms, and this is where Dr. Mahil, we also discuss it, the chronic fatigue, it's an unspecific description of something, they have some joint problems. The symptoms are not specific for the for any disease, you know. If you have some stressing factors, we also in today in these presentations, that must not be Lyme disease. You cannot say everybody has now Lyme disease. That would be completely wrong way, because it's not the truth. It depends. Where did you get the tick bite? Like my patient from Belarus, he got infected in Barcelona, and he had, I will speak with him about rickettsia now, rickettsia infection, and Borrelia. He had also some bulsar rashes afterwards, reactivated bulsar rashes. So multiple symptoms, multiple infections. That is the way we have to go. We have to look for different infections from my side. Yeah, thank you. And therefore, I developed this co-infection checklist. The patient has to fill it out. And I want to show you, maybe I show you the two ones of this. It's for me, I work with patients worldwide. We start now in Turkey, we start in Spain. We start, is it 10 or how many minutes? 10, so oh, I have time, okay. But I want to shorten it up, then we have more time for discussion. The co-infection checklist, that was my idea, because I heard a presentation, Joe Boroscano is a guru in USA, like Rich Horowitz, and they know a lot about, they saw 30,000 patients, 40,000 patients. And this co-infection checklist brings for a therapist the opportunity, you cannot keep all the symptoms of all infections in your brain. That's not possible. That was for me impossible. Look, so many symptoms, and you cannot remember each symptom. Is it now an Ehrlichia symptom? Is it now a Borrelia symptom? Is it Mycoplasma symptom? Is it Rickettsia symptom? Is it Yersinia? You have to, and you don't have the time in the with the patient to handle. So standardize the symptomatology, that's the next step. The cough, for example, can be also Mycoplasma, Chlamydia, Epstein-Barr virus at the beginning. You don't know. So the patients fill out, I force them to do that. This was a patient number one, a patient with stomach ache, a patient with feverish feeling, patient lack of concentration, patient with yellowish color of the skin, patient with painful joints, general aches and pain, flu-like symptoms, heart problem, no, cough, also fatigue, exhaustion, muscle pain, shivering, nausea, dark urine. For me at the beginning as an infectiologist, for me it's not important that he tells me now I have a chronic fatigue syndrome. I just want to know all of his symptoms. That's for me important. And many patients, they forget about their symptoms. They don't tell you their symptoms. You have to show them a symptom list. And then they say, oh yeah, I have also these symptoms with my eyes and with my urine and with my heart. Nobody asked me for it. Why the doctors, they don't have time. The GPs, they work very hard. They look into your eyes or into 6 minutes. You cannot do that. So you have to standardize something to do a good anamnesis, also for statistical data. By the ranking of that, that was the idea behind, this patient had 8 symptoms for chlamydia infection and 2 symptoms for position 2, 7 symptoms for mycoplasma, 7 symptoms for Coxsackie virus, and 6 symptoms for Bartonella. In medicine, I have a friend, he's an oncologist, he told me 90% of my diagnosis I do by symptoms. So if a patient is coming with intestinal cancer, he asks some key questions about blood in the stool and all the stuff, and then he knows without laboratory, okay, that can be intestinal cancer or prostatic cancer. You do some key question. We learned it in university. We have it in our brain. So the list is doing the same because symptoms are overlapping. And then I show you now the laboratory findings from that patient. Patient was suspicion by this ranking of the co-infection checklist for chlamydia, for mycoplasma, for Coxsackie virus. And we found out that this patient, positive immunoblot, a lot of bands, and activity in the Borrelia elispot, CD57 count low, chlamydia, pneumonia, IgA. IgA is so important. IgA is so important, not the IgM. Many laboratories do the IgM. IgM is the test for the hospitals, for the reason, for the fresh infection, for the acute situation, not for the chronic. We are asking for chronic local inflammations in your body. And IgA has half-life time, 5 to 6 days. That's the advantage. IgG has very long half-life times, 30 days. The chlamydia activity here was very high, 46. By this constellation, we had a chlamydia, very active infection for chlamydia, not such a high activity for Borrelia, and a chronic inflammation by the CD57 count, 49. And you cannot say the CD57 count is now low because of Borrelia or chlamydia. Mycoplasma was not done in that patient. I want to show you at the end. No, that's also very interesting. Patient 3, maybe we do. Patient 3 was a patient with lack of concentration, painful joints, general aches, heart problems, cough, headache, fatigue, exhaustion, muscle pain, and shivering. And the co-infection checklist told me 8 symptoms for chlamydia on top, second position mycoplasma again, third position Ehrlichia. That's it. So, and these are the laboratory findings. Antibodies negative, you see, I cannot exclude a Lyme disease by negative antibodies, that's not possible. The LTT, very high, 27 in the full antigen, 7 in the Gardnerella species. CD57 count low, 96. Chlamydia activity, 13. Ehrlichia, and this patient had anti-nuclear antibodies. Also, to look for autoimmune, we know the mimicry effect of the Borrelia can do that, ANA antibodies. You have to look also for children, and they can develop secondary collagenosis or rheumatoid arthritis, for example. So now the highlight, that was a patient from, patient from Spain. That was a Spanish patient. Some months ago, a patient with stomach ache, patient with fever, feverish feeling, lack of concentration, memory. The short-term memory is a symptom for Lyme and the infections, short-term memory loss. Yellowish color of the skin, painful joints, general aches, flu-like symptoms, heart problems, headache, fatigue, muscle pain, shivering, blood vision, nausea, vomiting, dark urine. And position 1, again, 8 symptoms for chlamydia. You always find chlamydia on top. That's like this koala, the koala story. It's very common. It's very common, chlamydia infections. A lot of people have symptoms with it, atherosclerosis, mycoplasma, Coxsackie virus. These were the findings. And now the laboratory corresponding, that patient had also, ELISA was positive for Borrelia, the IgG immune response, Borrelia activity by the LTT, Yersinia, big problem. Yersinia makes diarrhea, can make concentration problems, can make joint problems, can make HLA-B27. The Yersinia elispot was also high, 20 corresponding. Chlamydia IgA production, Chlamydia elispot high, mycoplasma IgA. These are all specific tests, not that you say these tests are all unspecific. They're all high specific tests by CE certified, and they are accepted by the CDC or by the NHS, for example. CMB CMB IgG was high. We don't have an IgA for CMB. I'm missing the IgA test. CMB ELISpot was high. Coxsackie virus infection in this patient here, IgA. Rickettsia antibody findings, a very high titer. EBV, the lytic antigen is so important for Epstein-Barr virus. It was 17 replication and CD57 count was low. So the checklist told me it's a multiple infection by the symptoms with Borrelia, Chlamydia, Mycoplasma, Coxsackie, Epstein-Barr, Rickettsia and Yersinia. The laboratory test told me exactly the same. Borrelia, Chlamydia, Mycoplasma, Coxsackie, Epstein-Barr, Rickettsia and Yersinia and CMV. So that Spanish, it was the first diagnosis. Very, a young man, very sick. 5 bacteria, 3 viruses. You know what I mean. He was not diagnosed by the system. And you shake your heads. That's right. I must not come there. So we have to educate the Spanish doctors too. And they are coming now in Madrid and Barcelona. They have to care also for their patients. You know, rickettsia, that seems a big problem in Spain, also Southern Africa. I think that's the way we go, education for the patients. That's my last slide. The viruses. That was the next challenge. What to do against viruses? If you ask doctors, we don't have any remedies against EBV, Coxsackie virus. I said, that cannot be. And I asked Lee Cowden, I know personally Lee Cowden, I asked Lee, I need something against the viruses. It cannot be that your protocol is so expensive. Lee Cowden is all others are also expensive. The patients don't have money. We heard it by Dietrich. He does the leukocytes and MCV and indirect. He wants to spare the money. That's the correct way you're doing. But on the other hand, we need virus protocols. And for me, there are not so many possibilities. But what I found out by this, we have the Takuna, the Berber, Sarmento, Serapeptase, Multi-Messenger, Artemisinin, the Nobel Prize winner, we heard about that, also against cancer, perfect. ATP, we have the transfer factor. Viruses are problematic. That's really, Dietrich, you told also, is it possible also to, we can discuss later, to eliminate the viruses? Very difficult to eliminate all of them. The mitochondropathies. We have the problem that these viruses are blocking in the mitochondria and they destroy them. The energy is away, and you know, some doctors in Germany, we are doing some hyperthermia, actually we are doing ozone therapy, oxygen therapy, apheresis. German doctors do a lot of these complementary, and what I have heard from patients that oxygen therapies are helpful, also ozone therapies especially. Some do apheresis, it helps also, and the hyperthermia, I cannot tell you what's happening with that. But nevertheless, if you treat a virus patient with antibiotics, that's also not the best. You know, you have either do a combination of antibiotics plus virostatics, but you know, have to know what's the enemy in your body. Otherwise, you cannot do the right therapy decision. And this is not to say we need now the laboratory, but I think you have also to invest at the beginning money to know what's your enemy. Not every patient has the same. We have so different patients. Also the genetics plays a role, the environmental, the pre-genetics. We have a complexity, and I think Rich Horowitz did the right description with a multisystemic disorder. So each patient is different from the other. And thank you. That's about the test. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.